Hello, students. This is the second attempt to get that lecture done. This is the same lecture I did the other day. So what I want you to do is take out that notes, set of notes you started with. It doesn't matter if they're not pretty. I want you to change the title, put this title here, Neolithic Revolution and Other Old Stuff, and we're going to try and go through the stuff I did the other day quickly. So there's your title. We're actually going to call this unit the Foundations Unit, which is just all the basic stuff I need to cover. I'm going to spend 2 or 3 weeks on it. And as we discuss the oldest skeleton of a human being found that has our DNA, I don't understand all the science behind it, was in Africa. And so I titled this Out of Africa. It's the name of a famous movie, probably based on a famous book. And here is Charles Darwin's book. And of course, it's where he comes up with the concept we call evolution. And I guess my picture's in the way, but you'll see various, I should have worn my paddle shirt. I have a shirt that has different kayak paddles, and it's called Paddlution. I'm probably going to ask you Friday how the original Americans or original humans, how humans originally got to the Americas. And as you see here, does it show up on this map? Yeah. They walked across, here we go. Walked across a land bridge from Asia to Alaska. At least that's the theory. All right, moving on here. My DNA test results. All right, so I spent some time on this. And again, this is all like a preamble, or it's a, basically, this is what happened before. This is way back before. And I told, there's three terms I want you to know. One of them is foragers or hunter-gatherer bands. This is just not, I don't need you to know this is just to pass an AP World exam. It is something that educated people know. You're taking this class not just to pass a college course exam, but to be an educated person. And you need to know that they have these hunter-gatherer bands, otherwise known as foragers. And we talked about all this. They were small groups. Originally, historians thought they had a pretty rough life. Now the theory is it wasn't as bad. It's still horrible. But compared to ours, but it was maybe there was more free time, leisure time than they thought. We talked about cave paintings. We talked about the discovery of the ice, the guy that is nicknamed the Iceman in the ice. Showed you all this, and they think it's a pretty accurate representation of what he was carrying and wearing when he died. This is just for fun.
The greatest calamity that could befall early men was the loss of fire. Fire, the mysterious phenomenon that cooked his food, heated his game, and kept him alive. If he could not start a fire, he and his would surely die. Most primitive man, the need to create was part of his nature. Artist. Man invented was the speak. So, death was good. Muppet says we're off the brief. Even in early man, the need to laugh was vital for emotional survival. Into notes and phrases. For mankind, it began with an accident. Gunga heard the sound and liked it. Gunga begged Gowie to repeat the beautiful scream, but Gowie could not. So Gunga thought and thought, and finally, he found the answer. And so, music was born.
So we talked about the discovery of farming now. As I told you, this is the most important thing that I talked about here. In agriculture, if you hear them say Neolithic Revolution, it's the agriculture revolution. Neolithic, Paleolithic, Old Stone Age, Neolithic, New Stone Age, New Stone Age. This will not be on the exam, but you could easily get an essay on farming, and it would look very good if you get an essay on agriculture or farming, which is not unusual in AP World History. They had an entire DBQ one year on the Green Revolution. Maybe twice they've had questions on that. This is how you would do the contextualization. I know we haven't talked about that yet. It's just really the second day of full class. But trust me, it would look good if you told this story. And so the discovery of farming, I'm not going to do the whole berry story again. I will throw this in. When we were a kid, when I was a kid, we had these ponds. Now, remember, I was born in Miami, but I grew up way out in the middle of the sticks, the woods. I mean, so we had ponds everywhere. And every so often, every 3 or 4 years, we'd go through a drought. I hope you know what a drought is. And all the ponds would dry up. And some of you may know over near Welch Road, where that big lake is, it's in Wakaba Springs State Park. Probably 10 years ago, it might have been longer than that, and you were probably too young to remember, that lake dried up, and before it dried up, it got really small. It's the one you see as you're going down, Welch Road. As you're going by Welch Road, you see that pond over there, that big lake is what it is. As it dried up, there were birds all over the place because the fish were trapped. The poor fish didn't have any place to go. The birds just ate them up. Now, I don't think the pond ever, or lake ever dried all the way up, but the small ponds where I'm from actually did. And I remember we would go back there just before the pond dried up and there were fish everywhere. Couldn't get away. So the pond dries up, right? So it's just an empty hole. Now here's the thing. If the pond dries up, there are no fish there. And then 6 months later, it starts raining again. And, within a year or two, the pond's full of fish again. If the pond dried up, how did the fish get there? Tell you what I'm going to do. We'll do this for fun here. If you can do this, especially without Googling it, why don't you email it to me, jerry.russell@ocps.net. All three of my classes are watching this video tomorrow. Why don't you try to figure out how that pond that dried up now has fish in it 2 years later? But there were stories like that. And I grew up in a hunting community. I was a hunter. I got my first shotgun. I guess this was scare everybody to pop when I was 14. I'm sorry, when I was in fourth grade, I was, I think, 7. So 410, it was a dove gun, a hunting gun, but I grew up around people telling hunting stories and farmers. There's a theory that there's just a natural way this stuff happened. There's a couple of theories. I think there's probably only one that's accurate about how those ponds, which were dry, a couple years later, we're full of different types of fish. You see if you can figure it out. All right. They're farmers. Okay. So I told you in the last slide, there were three terms I wanted you to know. I wanted you to know hunter-gatherer bands. I wanted you to know farmers. There may be another word we can use for that. Agriculturalists. I'm not sure if that's a word or not. I'm having some senior moments. Staying home with my dog. maybe I'm half asleep here. But so hunter-gatherers, one term. Farmers is the second term. And the third term you need to know is for the people who herd animals. Now, we think of people who have cows, and we call them farmers. Technically, they're not. And so they are pastoralists. Okay, so that's the three terms. And I might put that on Friday's quiz as well. I might say, what do you call those bands that wandered around looking for food? Hunter-gatherer bands. What do you call someone who plants crops? A farmer. That's easy. What do you call someone who herds? And I'm trying to go, I'm looking at the clock here. I'm trying to make this lecture 40 minutes so we can do it Thursday. But the thing is I always tell these stories to help get the semen in your mind. So they domesticated animals. There's a lot of debate about how they domesticated animals. And I know I'm a major dog person. The theory is with dogs is that you had wolves that would hang around the campsite where the hunter-gatherers were. And, you know, either to kill the hunter-gatherers or steal their food. And the theory is that some wolves were not as violent as others. Not as aggressive as others. And so what would happen, a wolf that wasn't that aggressive, there might be two wolves that were not that aggressive that hung around the hunter-gatherer band or followed it, and they would feed them their scraps. Now, they're not tame by any stretch of the imagination, but they would feed them their scraps. So what happens is the male and female wolf have, you know, wolf pups. And the theory is, and again, some of you are probably really into science. I am not. When I call you guys science geeks, it's really a compliment. I hated science. I'm not going to lie about it. But anyway, so it was not my favorite subject. The deal is, if you have two less aggressive wolves, that have pups or kits, whatever you call them, those kits are going to be less aggressive. And so then you have them breeding, their kits are going to be less aggressive. And as time goes by, they're going to be tame. And that's where dogs came from. There's a theory. Sodom and Gomorrah, why did I throw this in? This is going to show up later on in another slide. And I don't want to start the video again, so any mistakes I make, unless they're really bad, I'm going to leave them in. All right, so moving on, we're not going to cover that. I just threw some funny videos in. We talked about dogs. What you could do with a dog was you could domesticate them and get them to herd your sheep. And this right here is the world's worst sheepdog.
Nelson, come here. Here.
Actually,
Nelson.
I don't think this is a sheepdog at all. It's a poodle who thinks he, or whatever he is, that thinks he can herd sheep. But the sheep are going to herd him. Anyway, he bit off more than he can chew. All right, now this video, I got to tell you, I read this story years ago. And the longer you have me, you're going to realize I read a lot. I read a lot. I watch documentaries. And I'm always quoting something. And I used to have all these really smart kids. I'm sure I have some this year who'd ask me, you know, what's your source for that? I don't remember. If we ever go back to having, or I should say when we go back to having a normal classroom, I've got about 10 sayings I say all the time. I think I'm just going to type them up, print them, and put them up on the wall so I can point to them. I don't know where I read it. I don't know where I saw it. I'm almost 60. Give me a break here. But I read this story about someone wanted to test this theory. So what they did was they started breeding foxes. And the story I read, as I recalled, by the time they bred 20, you know, they would have a less aggressive fox bred with another less aggressive fox. They would have children. They would breed them. They'd have multiples of these. That by the time they got, I think it was 22 to 26 generations of breeding, the foxes were like house pets. And so I just thought I'd throw this video in. This is a totally domesticated fox.
Hey, silly. Hello, winter foxy. Run, run, run. Run, run, run. Run, 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 run.
I think this owner's a little sketchy.
Yes. Oh, yes. Yes. Oh.
I know you can't hear it. That's the sound of the baby fox. Actually, I don't think it's a baby. I don't think he's a baby. I think he's a full-grown fox. We used to have one that lived in our neighborhood, and we were going to church one day, and I swear, the fox, golly, I'm having technological problems, I swear this fox walked across the four-way stop in front of my house, and before he walked on the street, he stopped and looked both ways for traffic, and just trotted right by. We used to see him all the time. Unfortunately, we haven't seen him in years. I hope he's okay somewhere. All right, the effects of the agricultural revolution mucho dang importante. Very important. Spanish is the only foreign language ever. Chuck, I like to tell kids I'm fluent. That's a joke. Anyway, I'll tell you some more of my learning Spanish stories later on. This is very important. Okay. And this is not the most important thing, but you see how I've got political there capitalized? That means that anytime somebody's in charge, that's a political thing. When we get into AP World a bit later, I'm going to introduce you to my Spectre categories. And Spectre is, you know, S-P-E-C-T-R-E, and each of the letters means something. But political is like the most important topic in all of AP World History. And so when we say women lost power, it's a political thing now. I'm not going to go over the whole story again. I hope you got it yesterday. But when men were off hunting and gathering, women were left in charge. They were stuck with home at home because they were pregnant and had little kids around them all the time. Not all women. Some of them went hunting, but most of them were stuck back at home. They didn't have these two words that we have now back then, birth control. Anyway, women lost a lot of power. The cities grew. So this is growth of cities because now you can live in one place and people congregated together. So if you needed to go to the blacksmith, you'd have to go 20 miles. He lived nearby. So they could live in one place. I meant to put this down. I'm going to spell the word for you. Make sure this is in your notes. By the way, it's my first real lecture for you guys, other than you're already seeing me missing words. If you get used to that, the word is sedentary. S-E-D-E-N-T-A-R-Y. I actually Googled it before I did this lecture. Sedentary. And what that means is these people used to wander around all the time. Now they live in one place. They become more sedentary. And usually when you hear sedentary, it's referring to some old fat slob. Please don't think of me as an example. Who lays on the couch all the time and never gets up. He just uses the remote to go from his PlayStation to whatever's on, you know, Netflix. You know, Netflix. He Netflix and chills all the time. But anyway, they had a more sedentary lifestyle. They didn't move as much. Okay? Moving on, they had a stable food supply. Healthier, I think I told you the reason I have the question mark is just to make you educated. I just wanted to tell you, as someone who's been on many different diets, there's a theory that bread is actually bad for you. And this guy wrote this book called Grain Brain. But if you ignore all that stuff, which is really not that important for this course, a stable food supply led to people being healthier. Remember before, it was feast or famine, lots of food, no food. Here, you rarely have that period of time where you go without food for a long time, unless there's a drought or a flood or something like that. Rapid population growth, food surplus. Here's where this is really important. This is probably more important than at the top. Before, it took pretty much every person out there gathering food. Now, they have extra food. So instead of all 20 members of your band hunting and fishing, maybe 10 can farm and 10 can do other things. So if you have permanent houses, I don't see that I have that written here. Make sure you write that down. Several of you emailed that to me when I sent you the text message. Put down permanent housing. I did say they could live in one place. You could have someone who specialized in building houses or building roofs. So that was a consequence, maybe that's not the right word, a result of a food surplus. And the key thing is specialization. You must know this. Specialization now, and I told you now, I think probably one American farmer can feed 99 Americans. We have the best farmers in the world. I would guess, I'm sure there's some other countries like Australia that are close, but we feed not only our people, but lots of people around the world. Okay, I did forget to have that permanent building. All right, let's get to something new. And this is what years ago, they would have had, the original buildings. This was an old lecture I had, and I cut out a lot of stuff, and I left some of the graphics and videos in. All right, so one of the civilizations we no longer talk about is Babylon, but I want you to write this down. They had a king named Hammurabi, and again, if we were in class, I'd ask you if you knew what he was famous for, and here's what he's famous for. He had a law code. Now, that may not seem that impressive, But the fact that thousands of years ago, somebody wrote down a bunch of laws and said, if you do this, this will happen to you. Yesterday, we heard the code of conduct. The code of conduct is really a contract between Orange County Public Schools and the students. They might not call it that, but that's what it is. You know, if you do this, this is your punishment, or your punishment is among these punishments. So this, what happened when he did this law code, it's very, very famous. The reason I bring it up is there are going to be other law codes like Justinian law code, the Napoleonic law code later on, that if you get an essay on that and you can tie it to this, you get that contextualization point. Contextualization is 1 point on the LEQ and the DBQ. And I know it sounds to a lot of you like 1 point is not that important. Take it from someone who's been coaching over 20 years. I know I got some baseball players in class. We got some soccer players, I believe, as well. I bet you if you've been around long enough, you've lost many games by 1 point or won by 1 point. So 1 point is pretty daggum important. All right, so it's called the Code of Hammurabi. And I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but I want you to know this, because if you can dump this in your essays, by the way, I've graded AP World Essays. I think you saw that in my video. For 11 or 12 years, I don't even know how long. And you know what the word prejudice means. If you can write an essay that's really, really good and drop in lots of facts, your reader, we're supposed to grade off a rubric, but your reader is a human being. They very, very, very much want to give you a point. Because so many of the essays we read are so horrible. And so if you can drop lots of facts in, you're very likely to get an extra point. Okay? And knowing about Hammurabi is a pretty big deal. Again, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but it says here, I'm just going to read. I don't know that you can see this on the YouTube video. If a person puts out the eye of another free person, that person's eye shall be put out. That sounds equal, right? If a free person, the second one, a free person breaks the bone of another free person, that person's bone shall be broken. Again, feels rather equal. Not nice, pretty rot, but equal. The third one, if a free person puts out the eye or breaks the bone of a civil servant, the person shall pay 1/2 kilogram of silver. It's not equality. And the last one, if a free person puts out the eye or breaks the bone of another free person's slave, that person shall pay 1/2 the value of the slave. Now, something you're going to hear me say all course long is slavery has existed for thousands of years in pretty much cultures all over the world. And here's an example of that. But if a free person has their eye put out, and the person who did it has their eye put out, but if a slave has their eye put out, then the person who put the eye out pays the owner 1/2 the value of the slave. That is not equality. And so this is how you look at a law code. You look at this, and you can say at some point in your heart, in your mind, that ain't right and that ain't fair. Moving on, we're talking Israel here. So I got to move this up. This is number 5. There's Sodom and Gomorrah again. I think it's in my lecture too many times. Israel. This is number 5. It's Israel. So there were these people that were pastoral nomads. They wandered around, but they heard it. Okay, I don't know why I have Cain and Abel. You're not going to go quite back that far. Later on, there's a guy named Abraham. My lecture's a little out of order, but I don't want to film this video again. It's taking too long. There's a guy named Abraham, and the story goes that he had a relationship with God, and God made a promise to him, and his descendants became called the Israelites or the Jews. Now, just think about Sodom and Gomorrah, and I think I've got it in this lecture 3 times. I wanted to throw this in just because I find it fascinating. Now, a lot of you have heard the story of Sodom and Gomorrah, and the story, I'm not going to get into it. A lot of people a lot of people think this story is about homosexuality. I am not going to go near that topic and about that, but I will point this out, what a lot of historians think. So Abraham, Lot, who was related to Abraham, went and stayed in the city, okay? And anyway, there's trouble between these two groups, and God, who's made this promise to Abraham, this is what the story says, destroyed the cities. Now, some historians say, now think about this, what did Abraham do? Abraham and his followers were pastoralists. They moved around and they herded sheep. If Sodom and Gomorrah were cities and there were buildings and there's houses in the story, what were they? By definition, they were farmers. So I'm not going to, I grew up in church. My mother's a Pentecostal preacher. I've heard the story of Sodom and Gomorrah a million times. And maybe many of you have as well. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm not making any judgments on that story. I'm saying a lot of historians find it very interesting that there's basically two groups here, the pastoralists and the farmers, and there's trouble between the two. I can tell you that out west in the United States, there was a range war which made this young murderer famous who we know to history as Billy the Kid. It was a fight between ranchers and sheep herders, different types of people. The sheep, they thought, destroyed the grass and all that. Started by Abraham. There it is again. All right, so here's what I wanted to get to. The Hebrew Bible is called the Old Testament by Christians, and it's the first five books of the Old Testament, or the Torah. I just want you to know that. And I'm just, there's some other stories of the Jews. This is just so when we get talk about Judaism and Jews later on in AP World History, you have a bit of a foundation. You know most of these stories. They had a covenant with their God, Yahweh, and they had Ten Commandments. There's some other stuff here. Their first king was named Saul. The second one was named David. What the heck is this?
Happy do for you. Lord, I shall give these laws unto thy
Moses people. Coming down from the mountain.
Oh, hear me. All pay heed. The Lord Jehovah, has given unto you these 15. Ten commandments for all to obey.
I've shown those clips for years. Please do not be offended by that. Years ago, I had this girl I really, really wanted to go out with. Finally got a date. There were several of us that went together. And we went to the movie theater. And all the movies we wanted to see, the theater was full. And the only one left was this movie called History of the World Part 1. And these girls we were with, I told you I grew up in church. My mother's a preacher. These were religious girls. And we went into this movie, and it was just not what they expected or what I expected. And those clips I've seen, you'll notice I skipped around a little bit and skipped some parts. That's from this movie, History of the World, Part 1. All right, so without getting a whole lot into Judaism, their God is Yahweh. And here's the thing about their religion. It's monotheistic. Now, very important. Write this down. That means belief in one God. Now, a lot of historians give the Jews the credit for being the first to come up with monotheism. Just to make you an educated person, I'm going to throw some other religions out there that some people think may have been the first. One of them is the Egyptian religion. You know, that their God was monotheistic, whether Akhenaten. It was in this lecture. I chopped it out because you don't have to know about Egypt anymore until later on. But some people argue that the Egyptian religion was first. And if you remember, the Jews were slaves in Egypt. That's the story. And then what's the other religion? Zoroastrianism, which started, was a Persian religion in what we now call Iran. And so there are three. There might have been another one. Those are the three big competitors. I don't know if that's the right word to use. The three different religions that are credited, you can write them all down, Zoroastrianism, you can Google how to spell it, the Egyptian religion, but most people have given the credit to the Jews for being monotheistic. And the religions, that the two religions, if you don't know this, this is the class to learn this in, the two big religions that are going to come out of Judaism are Christianity, which is also monotheistic, and Islam, which is monotheistic. So those are your three great monotheistic religions there. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. You don't need to know all this. This word is important. So the Jews were captured by the Babylonians. There's going to be at least twice in history that the Jews are either captured or displaced. And what they're going to do is they're going to spread out. The more famous example is what the Romans do. And we may talk about that when I do my lecture on Christianity. But the deal is, this is called the diaspora. I've heard people call it the diaspora. I believe it is diaspora. And it is, I want you to put this, it means dispersion. So you have the Jews, who is this group with a common cultural identity, and then they are, in this case, what we're talking about here, they're made prisoners by the Babylonians. But while they're there for many years, rather than doing what many cultures do, which is blend with the dominant culture and become, trying to use big words today, an amalgamation, they keep their cultural identity. This is going to happen several times. When the Romans run the Jews out, I don't know if you've ever thought about this, Israel is in Asia, and Christianity is spread all over Europe. As a matter of fact, I teach European history, as you know, and in their lecture I had to tell them many people in history back in the day called Europe Christian Europe. Well, how did Europe get to be Christian? When Christianity comes out of Judaism, which is an Asian religion, it was because the Jewish people moved. Okay? And it was a diaspora. And, you know, a lot of people have never thought about it. If Hitler killed 6 million Jews, the Jews he killed, he got in Europe. Why were they there? It's because the religion had spread. Okay? All right. Anyway, just know the term diaspora. And there, you can write this down. They built a separate identity and maintained it through the centuries. I'm trying to get some better sound. I know my voice probably is not coming out very well. I have a very raspy voice anyway. I have a smoker's voice, even though I don't smoke. This is a song. I'm just playing it because I like the song. I will tell you, when you hear it, it gets stuck in your head, and you'll be singing it all day. We'll just listen to a little bit of it. So I'd like to say, I know some of you are Jewish, some of you are Christian, some of you are Muslim, some of you are Hindu, some of you are atheists. Please don't be offended by anything I say. When we talk about Hinduism here in a week or so, it's going to be pretty interesting. For years, Hinduism was considered polytheistic, and I had a student in class, and I'm probably going to tell this story again when I teach Hinduism, who stopped me, you know. When I was teaching that, because I said Hinduism is polytheistic, which means belief in many gods, she goes, she raised her hand. She goes, Mr. Russell, you guys have that wrong. We only believe in one God. There's different manifestations of our God. And we pretty much all teach that. That was like the first time I heard that. So if you are from a particular religion and I say something wrong, please let me know. I said it out of ignorance if I did. And I would tell you this. If you were in my class, you know, if I make a mistake, which you've heard me make many this lecture here, I want to know about it. This is a learning experience. I've taught 4 AP preps, AP Geography, AP World History, AP European History, and AP Macroeconomics. And the hardest one for me, to be honest, now kids will tell you economics is the hardest one, but the hardest one for me has always been World History. If I seem, it's easy to me now, it's because I've done it for a long time. Econ was hard for the first year. After that, it wasn't so bad. All right, moving on here. Okay, so we're about to run out of time. Go ahead and write this down. I think I got the wrong number here. Whatever the next number is, just write this down about early China. You might want to pause it, because I don't want to. China is the most important country in all of AP World History. So you might want to pause the video and write this. I'm going to go on. So again, if the numbers are off, don't worry about it. Just write China. And that was number one. This is number two under China. They have dynasties in China. And one of the oldest dynasty is the Shang Dynasty. And the key thing I want you to know here is, write all this down, but write down this thing about ancestor worship. Now, we call it ancestor worship. I had a Chinese girl in class, another example of someone who was explaining to me their culture. I want to hear this stuff. If you want to know anything about redneck culture, I can tell you. I am not married to my first cousin, though. Third cousin, just a joke. We're not related at all. And I have the DNA test to prove it. The key thing here is this ancestor worship. And she explained to me, now maybe she was wrong, that it wasn't so much worship, like we think of worshiping God. She goes, it was more like veneration, like your ancestors have influence with the gods. And here's an example. One year, this is, I don't know, 15 years ago, I had these two girls. They were Asian girls. I don't know if they were Chinese or not. I think one of them was. And I accused them of cheating. They copied each other's homework. And so I did what I thought I was supposed to do. I mean, I wrote them up, wrote a referral. And I got a call from the assistant principal. And he's a really nice guy. He called me and said, I got these two girls down here sobbing their eyes out. I said, what do you mean? He goes, well, you wrote them up for cheating. I said, they deserved it. They were cheating. He goes, let me explain something to you. And he was nice. He was a nice guy. He said, in their culture, and again, if you're from this culture and I'm wrong, I want to know. I'm just telling you what this guy told me. This assistant principal, my boss, he said, you have accused them of cheating, and in their culture, that means you have shamed them in front of their ancestors. And I got to know these girls, because I had them, hopefully I will have some of you for AP European History, and I'll have almost all of you for AP Economics when you're seniors, if I'm still here, I hope to be. But I had those girls for 2 or 3 years. Those girls would never cheat on anything. They thought it was okay to work together on the assignment. Looking back, I cannot imagine that I thought they cheated as much, you know, as I got to know them. But I did. This was like in the first few weeks of class. So this one girl, this is not one of the ones I accused, but she was friends with him. She said that ancestor worship may not be mean exactly to an American and like me. It's not really worship. It's more like ancestor respect or veneration. We're going to have a lot of difficulty in this class, but that's what can be fun about this class, learning about other cultures. Okay? And, anyway, moving on. Okay, I don't know what the heck that is. The general period, okay, I'm going to run short on time here. The longest, that is Z-H-O-U, I pronounced it Zhao for years, and then I had this one annoying girl in class. You know the kind that reads the pronunciation guide? I have the Russell redneck pronunciation. She actually, I'd get in class and just say a word the way I'd been saying it for 10 years, and she would say, actually, Mr. Russell, she was actually a wonderful girl. I like her a lot, but I kid around about her being annoying. It got to be a joke in the class. I pronounced stuff wrong just so she could correct me. So the deal is, she said it's Joe. So Z-H-O-U. Anyway, boom, most important concept here, mandate of heaven. I'm watching the clock. I may run 42 minutes. Mandate of heaven, here's what that meant. Now, again, this is a different culture. And it's, you know, I've had this a lot where you meet people who learn English and they use the same words I do, but they mean something totally different. And so I'm going to butcher this. I'm not Chinese, you may have noticed. But the thing is they have this belief that the ruler, I'm not even going to try and say God or gods, I don't even know how I would put that into words, what they believe. And modern-day Chinese may not even understand this, because this is from centuries ago. But they had this idea that the king was the son of heaven, okay? And when he ruled by the grace of the gods. And when he ascended to power, he had the, and you better know this, I just love the way this sounds, I've got it in capital letters, the mandate of heaven. You should try this you know, with somebody you like or don't like. Like if one of your other teachers is giving you a hard time, actually, I don't want to get in trouble. You guys don't know my sense of humor yet. But don't try this on mom and dad for sure. But don't just, you know, if somebody you respect, you're kidding around with them, they try to get you to do something you don't like, you can just say you have lost the mandate of heaven. But don't get me in trouble. Don't do it to Mr. Hines, for dang sure. But anyway, here's what they believe. The king could rule as long as he ruled wisely, but when he didn't rule wisely, he lost. Now, in Americanese, I think I would say he lost the blessing of the gods. But the Chinese, the ancient Chinese, would have said he lost the mandate of heaven. And here's what that meant. It meant that if he lost the mandate of heaven, he no longer had the blessing of the gods. And they could revolt. It's a very important deal. When we get to Europe in a little bit, the European kings ruled in the Middle Ages under what they call the so-called divine right of kings. This is different from the mandate of heaven. The divine right of kings said that God gave you the right to be king. God made you king. And because God made you king, anything you did was God's will. So if a king went in and says, kill everybody in this town, the Chinese would have probably said, well, any person bad enough to kill all these innocent people has clearly lost the mandate of heaven. The European king would have said, well, I know you consider me killing all these people wrong, but because I'm doing it, that makes it God's will. And so I'm just telling you, they're not the same. So mandate of heaven is a Chinese concept. The divine right of kings is a European concept. All right, we're going to have to leave this for another day. So we're going to finish up here for today. This is Thursday's lecture.